Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Official might be stretched, but
I don't know. I am here.
Hi, Eric.
Hi.
I do need you.
Hey, Holly. We're trading numbers. How are you?
Hi.
Hi.
The car looks amazing.
Does it?
I can't wait to.
Questions.
Yeah.
Well, that's what we got. We can't afford to.
Yeah. There's no question.
Hello.
Yeah,
how are you?
Hello. Hi. How are you? Good to see you.
You doing all right?
Yeah. Hello, Leslie.
Hello.
Oh, yes.
Thank you for coming.
for your support. I also, in particular, would like to thank our sponsors for their support of this event, for the work it honors and the cause it serves. They're identified on the scroll or the screen that's at the front and also in the programs on page 3. In particular, I'd like to call out the continued support from our platinum sponsors at CNN and Kilpatrick County. Our ability to do the important work for fighting for open and transparent government would not be possible without these folks and without all of you. And I would take a moment to thank you all for your help. Guests. I may miss somebody, but if you'll hold up your hands on the corner name so that people can find you, if you'll hold your applause until I get through with everybody, you won't be delayed in getting your hand. I would like to thank, we have U.S. District Court Judge Mark Cohen and clerk of U.S. District Court James Patton with us tonight. We also welcome Christopher Fadden of the Georgia Court of Appeals in San Antonio, I believe. From the Fulton County Superior Court, I believe we have Judges Wendy Hughes and Eric Dunaway here. Dave Whitaker, perhaps. There we go. I believe we have from the Georgia Department of Law, Dennis Dunn. There we go. Of course, we have a good friend and we'd like to welcome Walter Johnston, the regional director of the SEC. Thank you for his support. Tom Reyes, thank you. And we're happy to have Marianne Peters, the former U.S. Ambassador to Bangladesh and the CEO of the Harvard Center here tonight, as well as the honored guest and the speaker. We also have several members of Judge Stephanie Manis's family here tonight to accept her posthumous award as our Hope and Government Hero. We're very pleased to have her. And it's been our great pleasure over the years to have members of the Weltner families who started the Weltner Awards and have been conscientious and generous with their time and always had members to support this. And we're here just as well. My son Phil Weltner is here and he presented the award. And we also have Susan Yao's husband, Susan Weltner's daughter. He's standing in for her. As well, I believe we don't have to all raise your hands, but there's a number of students here with us tonight from Tennessee State and from Emory, and we're delighted to have you here too. Thank you for joining us for tonight's celebration. Please enjoy your dinner, and Sean will be back to start the program by the time we get to dessert. So again, thank you for your support. Thank you.
is a professor at Emory, has donated a pair of Eagles tickets for tomorrow night. So if you want to get your Eagles tickets, step outside in the next 20 minutes and put in your bid. We have a silent auction for Eagles tickets. Anything to add to that? You get to sit with Hank and his wife, Laura. They're loving the whole of it right now. Alright. Please go ahead and enjoy your coffee and dessert and have another cocktail. And we're going to go ahead and get started with the program. I'm Sean McIntosh, and I'm the president of the Board of Directors of the First Amendment Foundation. And before we crank into our program, I just want to take a few minutes and update you on the important work that your Georgia First Amendment Foundation has done for you in the last year. As you probably know, we fight for government transparency and freedom of speech, and we're the only organization in the state of Georgia that's 100% committed to that mission. We were founded in 1994, and we're a nonprofit organization. We educate citizens, public officials, journalists, lawyers, others on Georgia's open records laws, open meetings, and free speech laws. In the past year, we spent a whole lot of time at the Capitol. Some of you may know that sometimes that involves more playing defense than playing offense. And we were playing a lot of defense this year. There were a few nail-biting moments, but all in all, during the General Assembly session, the lawmakers treaded lightly on Georgia's rights. That's not always the case, so we were happy with that. Our most active work this year, the foundation fought to make sure that House Bill 15, which requires electronic filing of court records, included protections for public access to those court records that are filed electronically. The bill was amended repeatedly as it made its way through the House and the Senate, and it ultimately failed to get out of a conference committee. That was a happy occasion for the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. The final version of the bill could have been paired free and needed access to records in court, and so we were ready for it to go back into discussion. The future of the bill was a good result for Georgians, and it will go back into discussion. We expect it to come up again this year, and we're a little bit more optimistic about access provisions. We also this year held a legislative breakfast. This is a new thing for us. We're in our second year, where we convene citizens to talk about the laws and access provisions that might come up in the legislature, help them be better informed and better participants in government. It was an early success for us 2 years in a row now, and we're going to try and make it an annual event. So if you're sponsored down there, if that's something you're interested in and want to sponsor, we'd be happy to have you. Outside of the General Assembly, we've been working really hard to make sure that a real right of the Rule 22, which is the rule that gives people access to take photographs and videos and otherwise record in courtrooms, that it doesn't step a step back from its long tradition of welcoming and encouraging the press and public in courtrooms. Right now, it's a fairly good rule that lets you have access to courtrooms and the press can film and record, and we want to keep it open. So we've been working on that. We were active in the courts quite a bit this year on issues ranging from whether a hospital can operate without public transparency, if it's operating on behalf of a public hospital authority, whether courtroom audio recordings are public records, as the transcripts of audio courtroom recordings are, and how to balance the rights of a defendant in a highly visible court case with the rights of the community to know what's going on in that court case. There's always a balancing act. You can learn more about those cases and others who were involved in your program. In addition, we conducted lots of workshops to train citizens, law enforcement, and journalists about access to video from police body cameras, and protections for citizens who report police with their cell phone or with a camera. This is an emerging area where sometimes the police don't quite understand that our constitutional laws allow people to have pictures while they're on their job on the streets. So sometimes we have to remind folks of that. We've updated our open record and open meetings workshops. I'm Jim Zachary and Ken Foskett for doing that. They're doing some powerhouse training for citizens, public officials, and journalists. If you want to have one for your organization, we would love to come and see you and help you put on one of those sessions. And of course, as we are here today doing, we work to honor and celebrate Georgians who work for government transparency. As many of you know, 3 years ago, we awarded the Weltner Award to Georgia's Judicial Qualifications Commission for a ruling that strongly reinforced the importance of open judicial proceedings. The JQC is responsible for investigating complaints of judicial misconduct and disciplining judges. Unfortunately, there's a recent sign that the work of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation is constant, ongoing, and always needed. The organization that earned our award just 3 years ago is now raising concerns about its commitment to transparency. Since that honor, the commission has been dismantled and reconstructed, with legislative advocates behind that effort saying the reorganization would bring more transparency and more accountability. Yet the organization recently issued a decision that has us concerned. The definitive judge who pursued indictments and jailed a North Georgia journalist on charges related to his journalistic work. The charge was ultimately dismissed after media organizations and others raised an alarm. Yet the JQC in their recent decision sharply chastised the organizations that requested that the commission take a look into the arrest. Now, we're still researching the matter and not everything is known, and so I want to be clear about that, but we expect we'll have more to say. These developments are troubling and do make us wonder if the reconstituted JQC is going to be as transparent and open and committed to open course as we hope that it is. Finally, a bit of informal news for the First Amendment Foundation. Many of you know that Holly Banquet retired from her role as executive director this year after 2 decades with the organization.
Encourage government transparency.
Judge Stone will offer a tribute to our awesome governor, Andrew Grove, Judge Stephanie Manis, and help us present the award to Judge Manis' family. Thanks.
Good evening. The other day, I tried to think of one word that best described Stephanie Manis, and the first word that came to mind was dynamo. I wanted to make sure this was the right word, so I Googled it, and the following definition appeared: a forceful, energetic individual. I think that's a pretty accurate description of my friend and colleague of 35 years. When Stephanie decided to go to law school in 1974, it was a time when women were not that well represented in the practice of law in Georgia. Not to mention that Stephanie was 34 years old and had three children. But Stephanie was one of several women of that time who decided to combine a legal career with raising a family. And she became an inspiration to many others of her generation in Atlanta and in Georgia. She graduated Emory Law School in 1977 and became a law clerk for Georgia Supreme Court Justice Harold Hill. And then 2 years later, she was hired by her mentor, Arthur Bolton, to become an assistant attorney general for the state of Georgia. Now, when you talk about some of the heroes of open government in this state, many of you might not remember Arthur Bolton. Prior to his appointment as attorney general by Governor Carl Sanders, the attorney general's position was basically known as the lawyer for the governor. And the office was not exactly a place that was a bastion of open government. But when Governor Sanders asked then state representative Arthur Bolton, his legislative floor leader, to fill the existing attorney general vacancy, Bolton said he would do it under one condition: that he could run the office independently of the governor and call the shots according to the law, no matter whose ox was being gored. Sanders agreed, and Bolton became AG. Well, within a couple of months, Bolton issued an opinion that stated that an action that Governor Sanders was about to take was illegal. Sanders called Bolton to his office and asked, "Arthur, what are you doing?" Bolton reminded Sanders of their earlier conversation. Sanders remarked, "I didn't think I'd be the first ox." I was told that same story by both of them, so I know it is not fake news. So Stephanie Manis followed in the footsteps of Mr. Bolton, and during her 16-year tenure in the Attorney General's office, she became one of the leading voices for open government, and not just for state government. Stephanie wrote numerous opinions, including that local government agencies and officials had to comply with the open records and open meetings laws. I joined the state law department 2 years after Stephanie, and she took me under her wing and schooled me in the virtues of open government. In fact, we co-authored the Open Government, Open Meetings Annual Review for the Mercer Law Review. This is the copy, fall of 1988, and I'd like to read you just the opening of that article. At the heart of representative democracy is the notion that those who undertake the privilege of government service are accountable to the people. This is not merely an ideal. Indeed, one need only look at the Georgia Constitution, which declares public officers are the trustees and servants of the people and are at all times amenable to them. Public awareness of the operation of government can provide a necessary check on the abuses of power that Montesquieu prophesied and that the public rediscovered during Watergate. Good government has become increasingly synonymous with open government, and one means by which citizens can be informed about the daily workings of their government is through what has become known as sunshine laws and open records laws. These are the words of Stephanie Manis from about 30 years ago. And I know that they're her words and not mine, because I would not have known how to quote or spell Montesquieu. Nowadays, we take for granted the number of laws on the books that protect citizens' access to meetings and records of state and local agencies. The average citizen can even file an open government complaint on the law department's website, and the attorney general's office now has an open government mediation program to assist members of the public. I will tell you that none of this would be in place without the earlier leadership of heroes of open government like Stephanie Mills. Although the State Law Department was authorized during the 1970s and 1980s to advise state agencies and their officials in terms of compliance with open government directives, there was no law that allowed the State Law Department to challenge local government's efforts to avoid the application of sunshine laws. I personally observed Stephanie through taking numerous phone calls from average citizens complaining about their lack of access to the very public officials they voted into office. Stephanie would at times spend an hour or more on the phone with an average citizen, counseling them about what options they had to challenge actions taken by their city council or their county commission. Although she was not authorized to file a lawsuit on their behalf, she believed it was important for citizens to have someone they could speak to who would not give them the runaround they often got when challenging local government secrecy. She always used to say, when someone in government refuses to provide information that the law requires them to, it usually means there's a illegal or improper activity going on. Stephanie Maness was an early and consistent defender of open government in Georgia. During her 16 years in the Attorney General's office, Stephanie was promoted several times and became the first woman appointed as Deputy Attorney General, one of the three section leaders of the law department and the third highest position in terms of hierarchy. And she still remained the go-to person when it came to open records and open meetings. On May 31st of 1995, she was appointed to be Superior Court Judge of Fulton County by Governor Weltner. During her over 20 years on the bench, Stephanie applied the lessons she learned and taught others about open government to her handling of legal disputes. Whenever litigants tried to file documents under seal or close court proceedings, Stephanie's position was, it's open or public unless you can show me where in the law I'm authorized to keep the matter out of the public eye, and even then, why should I do it? When I became a judge, I often went to her for advice, and she always told me that to make sure whenever possible, all cases should be litigated in public. To this day, whenever I get a request from a party to seal a record or close a proceeding, my first inquiry to myself is, what would Stephanie do? The answer is usually pretty obvious. For most of the Weltner Award dinners, my wife Bonnie and I would sit with Stephanie and her beloved husband Bob, and I know how much she enjoyed these events because of her love for and dedication to open government. Stephanie passed away last December after being stricken with pancreatic cancer, and is represented here today by her husband of 49 years, Robert, and her daughters Lisa and Tamara. Her third daughter, Valerie, is on a work assignment in Chicago, and I know she's also thinking of us tonight. I also know that Stephanie would be very proud to have been recognized at an event that she so often attended and admired. On behalf of the Maness family and all Stephanie's colleagues and friends, we thank the Georgia First Amendment Foundation for presenting their Open Government Hero Award to the Honorable Stephanie B. Maness.
Thank you. case at length, we talked about what the options were, and ultimately, Charles felt that the boy was abused by his parents. He was, and that he should have had a better option than the death penalty. He did go to court. He did, I don't recall whether it's for jail time or not, but he did avoid the death penalty. And for this, somehow I always thought of Charles. Well, that's a terrific person, this terrific lawyer who can help kids, can help people.
Is nonpartisan because because it is based on values. Values embodied by President and Mrs. Carter. Compassion, respect for human dignity, belief in democracy, that I do believe, I still believe, are shared by the vast majority of Americans across the political spectrum. And the final principle, which I will quote verbatim, is the center believes that people can improve their own lives when provided with the necessary skills, knowledge, and access to resources. And that one is about the core value of human dignity. The center often works at the end of the road with people who have little but their dignity. The Global Access to Information Program embodies these five principles. As you all know, the right of access to information is a fundamental right in Article 19 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and it's necessary for good governance, transparency, accountability, and the effective exercise of other human rights. I know the mission of the program will resonate with many of you in this room. It is to assure that meaningful information reaches all persons and that this information may be used to transform lives. Access to information programming at the Carter Center began in 1999 as part of the Latin American program's anti-corruption efforts. But the Carter Center soon understood the value of information beyond just the anti-corruption agenda. And because we are the Carter Center, we began to take a broader human rights approach to advancing access to information. We began in Jamaica, informing the debate about their draft access to information law, and then remained there after the law was passed to help support the government in implementation. The work of the ATI program then expanded throughout the Latin American and Caribbean region. And the program was then invited to work in Mali and even in China. In 2015, this work became one of six program areas in the peace pillar of the Carter Center. And the program now has field offices in Liberia, Guatemala, and Bangladesh, and programming in other countries. I'm really proud of the innovative work of the Center's Global Access to Information Program and its staff. Our work, for instance, to assess the extent and quality of a particular country's access to information laws implementation is the only tool of its kind. And I'm particularly proud that Laura Newman and her team were the first to identify that women, by and large, are not able to access information as easily or as successfully as men. Now I wasn't there, but I've heard that when Laura first raised this insight with President Carter, he said, yes, but can you prove it? And in fact, we can now prove that where men have difficulty obtaining information to which they have a right, women have more difficulty. Our ATI team has conducted mixed method studies in Liberia, Guatemala, and Bangladesh. And in all of those three countries, we found that women face additional obstacles to exercising their right to information. Obstacles that, of course, we then take into account in designing the programs to rectify some of those disparities. Personally, I love the stories that this program generates. In Liberia, I met incredible women who started a farming co-op once they found out they were actually entitled to some nearby land. And by the way, these were rural women who, until 2003, were actually the property of men. Now, the law was changed in 2003, but nobody bothered to tell most of them that. So if that isn't a good argument for access to information, I don't know what is. And if Laura, in her presentation, doesn't mention how chickens are transforming villages in Guatemala, please be sure and ask her about that. So thanks once again to the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, both for its outstanding work in advocating for all of us on all of our behalves within the state of Georgia, and for recognizing the Carter Center's Access to Information Program for its contribution to this foundational human right. And now it's my great pleasure to introduce the program director of our Global Access to Information Program, Laura Newman. Laura has led this effort since governance programming, including ongoing and past projects in Latin America, Africa, and as I mentioned, China. Laura is a recognized expert in this field. She has written many articles and book chapters on the right of access to information. She has edited 6 widely distributed guidebooks on fostering transparency and preventing corruption. And she has presented countless international seminars on access to information legislation, implementation, enforcement, and use. Laura serves as a member of the International School of Transparency and the Transparency Advisory Group. She's an advisory member of the Open Democracy Advice Center and co-anchor of the Open Government Partnerships Access to Information Working Group. Prior to joining the Carter Center in 1999, Laura was a staff attorney at Legal Action of Wisconsin. She's a proud 1993 graduate of the University of Wisconsin Law School. Laura.
In Mozambique in 1988, the state of South Africa bombed his car in
an attempt to kill him. Miraculously, he lost one arm and the sight in one eye. In a conference that my program held here in Atlanta in 2008 regarding the right of access to information, Albie Sachs came and he spoke of how personal this right had been to him. While Justice Sachs was imprisoned in South Africa, his jailers committed many atrocities against him in order to get him to admit to fabricated charges. After many weeks of enduring the torture, he finally signed a statement of guilt. However, at the very top of that document, he made a notation, a small marking that he had been tortured and was signing this document under duress. Some years later, after the fall of apartheid and the passage of the new democratic constitution, which he helped draft and which included the right of access to information, Justice Sachs was invited to open the new South African archives. Somewhat impulsively, he asked one of the clerks if there happened to be a file there under the name of Albie Sachs. He was unsurprised when the clerk came back and said no, as he could have not imagined that the records of his imprisonment and torture had been kept. But he asked the clerk to look again under his formal name of Albert Sachs. A few minutes later, the clerk appeared with a file, and when Justice Sachs opened it, out fluttered the document that he had signed 30 years earlier with that small note that he had written about his torture. As Justice Sachs recounted, this one paper, this one official document, preserved and made available to him through the right of access to information, validated all his memories, his identity, and his personhood. Unfortunately, it's not always that easy. There are many challenges that governments face when instituting a right of access to information. And in many ways, I would argue that this is one of the most difficult laws to operationalize, as it is often contrary to the existing institutional culture of secrecy, and it touches on the whole of public administration. Where a policy on education, for example, may only be applicable to the Department of Education, or a new law on taxation, only really relevant to the IRS, a Freedom of Information law imposes new requirements and responsibilities on every part of government and every public official. And too often we see that there is insufficient political commitment to the right to information, particularly when that information may be embarrassing. There are also realities that we encounter in many of the countries where we work, lack of institutional capacity and insufficient resources. And the demand for information may not be as high because of a lack of awareness or fear from requesters. The most consistent challenge we've seen, though, is poor records management. Some of these are pictures that I was able to take working in the various countries. As you all know, without records, there's really no right to information. And yet, this is the state of records around the world. The one on the top left is in Bolivia, in South America. That's the basement of the Ministry of Mines. And those are the documents that the ministry has, including all of their contracts on mine exploration and mineral rights. The photo on the right is not one of mine, but it's from India. And the bottom one is a photo from Mali, where we used to work. This is in a government office outside of Bamako, the capital city, and what you see there is a pile of land titles. And as you know, land disputes are often a cause of conflict. And if land titles cannot be produced or are not trusted, this can lead to violence. And yet that was the state of their records when we began. Recognizing the challenges faced in advancing the right to information, the Carter Center's Global Access to Information Program seeks to address these obstacles by working with both government and civil society on four interrelated pillars of programming. We assist target countries in establishing an access to information regime, from passing a law through its implementation, enforcement, and use. We've developed a tool that Ambassador Peters mentioned to encourage more effective implementation, and we call it our implementation assessment tool. We support marginalized populations to exercise the right to information and enjoy its benefits, particularly focusing on women. And we serve as a resource and support the global community of practice working on transparency, accountability, and access to information. As you can see, we take a both qualitative and quantitative approach to our work. We only engage in countries where we've been invited, and we work with all relevant stakeholders. Over the past 18 years, we've worked in six target countries to assist national efforts to advance the right to information. This work includes setting up long-term field offices, which are always led by local professionals, providing comments and support in establishing legal mechanisms, assisting governments in implementation and enforcement, and working with civil society to use the law to benefit their lives. Presently, our general freedom of information work support is focused in Liberia, where we've been working since 2009 to institute a culture and capacity for freedom of information. Critical to our work is to move beyond the capital city and into local communities to encourage citizens to exercise their right to information. One such person was George Taddy, and that's the gentleman you see on the left. George was a high school student in Lofa County in the far northeast of the country. George had taken the West African entrance exam because he was going to be the first person to enter college from his family, but he failed the math and science sections. George felt that these were his strengths and could not understand how he and most of his peers, almost all of them, had failed those same sections. George had previously come to a workshop organized by the Carter Center and learned of his right to information. With our support, George wrote to his local district education office asking for a copy of the national curriculum for math and science. What he found was that his teachers had not followed the curriculum, and therefore he was not properly prepared for his college entrance exam. He took these findings to the district education authorities and then to the ministry, and changes were made to assure that the teachers were better prepared and trained at the and the national curriculum was followed. The other photo is one of Kuta Bypass Bridge in another county in Liberia, Rangiga. This bridge had been damaged and was unusable for years. Without this bridge, residents would need to walk hours to get from the village to the main town. The county authorities kept promising that it would be fixed, but nothing happened. Following an awareness-raising event on the right to information, villagers requested information about this very bridge. Now, while they never got the documents, and that often happens, they did, as you see, get their bridge. Recently, we received some funding to work specifically on transparency and access to information in the justice and security sector in Liberia. We are engaging directly with the Liberia National Police, the Court Administration, and the Bureau of Immigration to help them to be more responsive to citizens' needs for information and to develop other mechanisms to be more transparent and increase trust. This work really paid off during the elections, which were just held less than 2 weeks ago, as the security forces use the capacity that we help them develop to provide more information about their role and to respond to citizens' concerns. And the trust in the security over this election was markedly different than in previous elections. Now, we've always said that passing an access to information law is the easy bet. The most challenging for governments is implementing and operationalizing the law. We were often asked by our government partners about good models and best practices, but there was really nowhere to turn, as no one had developed international norms or done any real assessments related to implementation. Perhaps misguidedly, as like many of you, I'm a lawyer and not a social scientist, I thought, how hard could it be to come up with some indicators around implementation? Well, 6 years, three pilot phases, 11 countries, 65 agencies, and literally thousands of indicators later, we now have the final implementation assessment tool. As Ambassador Peter said, it's the only one of its kind, and since finalizing the indicators and methodology, we've applied the IAT in 4 more countries. The implementation assessment tool assesses the extent and quality of implementation of an access to information regime by agency. It's not an index across countries. We don't say one country is better than another, but rather use it as an input for each agency to identify where they've made progress and where additional efforts are needed. There are 60 indicators related to leadership, rules, system, resources, and monitoring. And as you can see, each indicator is given a color using a stoplight methodology. At the conclusion of the assessment, which includes local researchers, blind peer reviewers, focal groups, and narrative reports, there's a facilitated meeting of government and civil society to share the findings and identify priority actions. It's these actions that government agencies are taking to improve their implementation so that ultimately, when people ask for information, they're able to receive it. Our newest programming is built on our core commitment to assuring an equitable right of access to information. Please allow me to ask you all just a very simple question. How many of you think that marginalized persons, particularly women, should be able to get information. It may seem like a silly question, but around the world, women struggle to receive information that they need to become more economically empowered, to support their families, and to be free from violence. Women carry the double burden of income generation and caring for her family. 70% of the world's poor are women, and economic opportunities remain limited. Women are more susceptible to the ill effects of corruption as they lack influence and money to pay bribes. And women often are victims of violence, with an estimated 35% of all women having experienced some gender-based violence in her lifetime. But information can change this. We believe that when women receive information, they can transform lives. As an example, now this table's not allowed to answer. As an example, think about the statistics related to when women receive money. If a woman receives a dollar, how much do you think she reinvests in her family? How much?
$2.
A woman reinvests approximately 90% of every dollar in her family. How much do you think a man reinvests in his family when he receives a dollar? Between 30 and 35%. But often in our societies, it is the most vulnerable and marginalized who suffer most due to lack of information. In Liberia, we often hear stories of women being excluded from critical information flows. In one of the counties we work in, we heard the story of a village where women were shepherded into a hut, and a county mannequin, a county devil, was placed at the entrance. The women were warned not to leave the hut, or else they would be possessed by the devil and banished from the community. In the meantime, the men would gather, share information with one another, and make all the decisions for the village. Once decisions were made, the women were let out of the hut, thus assuring that women had no participation or voice in decision-making. And in Guatemala, where we also work, women who were working with us on our study were not even allowed into public offices, or were attacked and told that they should not be asking questions. This is in Guatemala, where femicide is one of the highest in the world. Women speak of fear of asking for information, that she wouldn't go into a public office without a man, without her husband or son, and examples of intimidation when trying to get information are rife. We first began considering programming related to women and access to information following an African regional conference that we held in Ghana in 2010, when we had that famous Oprah aha moment, and realized that women and women's organizations, by and large, had not been at the table. For every woman we invited to the conference, she substituted herself with a man. It got to the point that when we opened the conference, of about 140 people, President Carter said, "Would all the women in the room please stand up?" My colleague Carrie's with me, and another handful of women, which were, by and large, the only women in the room. When we went back to try and understand this phenomenon, we realized that there was very little data, and definitely very little disaggregated data, about women requesters versus men. There had been one study by PricewaterhouseCoopers, for example, in India, that found that of all the requesters, only 6% were women. We went to President Carter with our hypothesis that women are not able to exercise their right to information with the same frequency, ease, and rate of success as men. And as Ambassador Peters told you, he appreciated our hypothesis, but very wisely suggested that we develop a study to demonstrate this, to underpin and support our future programming. He understood, much better than I, that governments were not going to change their behaviors unless we could demonstrate the problem. The study that was mentioned took place in Liberia, Guatemala, and Bangladesh. We trained local researchers to conduct interviews, and the non-participant observation, where they went into agencies to see what happens when a woman comes in and what happens when a man comes in. How are they treated? Overall, our local researchers interviewed more than 1,700 people and visited 130 different public agencies, each one visited 3 times. Not surprisingly, between 60 to 80% of the community leaders felt that women were not able to exercise their right to information with facility as men, whereas the vast majority of public officials that we interviewed felt felt that there was no difference between men and women, that even though what we observed in the agencies was quite different, our researchers spoke of women being ignored, derided, or verbally attacked. Men were helped before women, even if she was there first, and were not questioned about their information needs the way that women were. In a number of occasions, as I mentioned, even our female researchers were not allowed into the agencies. Now imagine an Indigenous woman who doesn't speak the main language coming to an agency to seek information. As part of the study, we asked, what are the main obstacles that women face in exercising the right to information? And most often we heard of illiteracy, fear, not knowing where to go or how to access information, lack of time and mobility. As many of us in the room know, that women, regardless of where we are busy, whether we're taking care of the family or the home or making sure our kids get to school and the dinner is ready, when we're doing subsistence farming, gathering water, regardless, we have all of these duties. So even when we know the information we want, there's often very little time or access to get that information, and often many cultural obstacles. Based on the studies, we began our access to information programming, and I'd like to just share a few of our success stories. In Liberia, I was recently able to participate in a follow-up activity in a small village outside of the capital of Monrovia, a place called Po River. The women had already received one workshop on the right to information, and when we returned to the village, we wanted to see what they had done with their newfound knowledge, and it was inspiring. One woman shared that she'd gone to the local education office to find out why they were being charged fees for primary school, which should be free. Another woman said that she didn't know her ABCs and didn't think she had a right to ask for information, but now she knew that she could request information even though she was illiterate and couldn't read the information herself, that it was still her right. A third woman, perhaps my favorite, stood up and said that after learning about her right to information, she asked her husband how much he was spending on his other secret family. Now, while certainly an important issue, we told her that this would likely not fall under the Freedom of Information Act of Liberia, and that a denial from him would not be enforceable. Similarly, in Guatemala, women were able to identify and eloquently explain their many information needs. Now, as part of our programming, in addition to raising awareness about their rights, in each of the countries we work, we also establish information facilitators, information ladies. These are women from the community armed with laptops who visit communities to help women make requests and seek information. And in one of those communities, in El Quiche, one of the poorest areas of Guatemala, they knew that they were supposed to receive economic empowerment projects from the government, but it had not come. With the help of our information facilitator, they made a request for information. This is our famous chicken story that Ambassador Peters mentioned. Now, again, as I said before, as often happens, they received no documents after they made their request about this economic empowerment program, but what they did get was 136 chickens. These women are now able to sell the eggs for money and use the extra to feed their children in a place that has some of the worst chronic malnutrition in the world, all because they made a request for information. Finally, in Bangladesh, our local civil society partners are gathering women to hold village courtyard meetings. They share information about women's right to information and identify their many information needs. In this village, the women ask the government about artisan training opportunities. Following the request, some of the women receive training in sewing, in making batik, and weaving. These are skills that will assist women to become more economically empowered in places where women are often not even allowed to leave their home. The center recently developed a video which we think really helps highlight women and the right of access to information. So if this works.
Access to information is a universal right, but across the globe, women often have trouble exercising this right. Without proper documents, they are cut off from important services. Without meaningful information, they can't make their voices heard. Many women have no time to seek out information because they face the double burden of earning an income and caring for their families. On others don't get the information they need because they are not aware of their rights, or live in cultures that discourage women from pursuing them. As a result, in some parts of the world, only half the population can fully access information and the benefits it provides. But what if that changed? Information has the power to transform the lives of women around the world, helping them to understand the full range of their rights and to participate in public life, empowering them to achieve economic success and to make better decisions for their families and futures, enabling them to hold government officials accountable and to bring about change in the areas that matter most to them. The Carter Center's Global Access to Information Program is working with countries around the world to help ensure women get the information they need. Inform women, transform lives.
In the case of Davis versus the City of Macon, he found that public officials are beholden to the people and that they, quote, must conduct the public's business out in the open. These ideals of open government, trust, rights to information, and meaningful voice that he espoused in 1992 are the same that the Carter Center's Global Access to Information Program advances throughout the world today. The last sentence of his opinion notes that, quote, he is confident of the future. And with advocates such as the Georgia First Amendment Foundation and its supporters, we too remain confident of the future of the right to information. The Carter Center and I began our access to information programming in 1999 with the notion that meaningful information can transform lives. And as you might have noticed, I'm truly passionate about access to information as a fundamental right and what it can do for people. On behalf of the Carter Center, Ambassador Peters, and my amazing team in the Global Access to Information Program, we thank you for this wonderful honor.
Thank you all.